love.
You went to Detroit after that?
No, while I was in New York.
Early.
Before the war.
Okay.
Made in the Ozarks was starting up another cast. And they said, we're going to Chicago. If you want to be in the show, go down
and
audition for the two little Pfeiffer brothers.
And they were the same guys in L.A.?
No, it's a new team.
New team?
Pfeiffer brothers.
And did you tell them that when you went to
audition? They knew that Berman Bodell and Mrs. Fisher and I had played in the show.
In L.A.?
Yeah.
How long in L.A. was it?
139 performances.
You went 139 performances for a whole month or 6 months?
Yeah.
And then, after that, you went to New York City. I see.
And I went to New York.
I see.
Then,
now that
I got a letter telling me that they're going to audition.
That's great.
For this show again, and I hadn't gotten nowhere in New York
City. So you wanted to go and take that.
I said, well, if I can get it, I'll take it. 13 weeks. So, first go to Chicago.
Uh-huh.
And Mr. Bodell from L.A., remember, I guess Grandma, Mrs. Fisher, she got it.
Yeah.
They all came to New York, to Chicago. So then I said, I put my bags and clothes and stuff in storage in New York, thinking I'd get back to it.
The loveliness of Paris seems somehow sadly gay. The glory that was Rome is of another day. I've been terribly alone and forgotten in Manhattan. I'm going home to my city by the bay. I left my heart in San Francisco. High on a hill, it calls to me to be where little cable cars climb halfway to the stars. The morning fog may chill the air. I don't care. My love waits there in San Francisco. Above the blue, and when D.C. when I come home to you, San Francisco, your golden sun.
Hi, my name is Kirk Hunter. Alberta Casey Hunter, my mother, recently passed away, and I thought I would put together some slides and some pictures of those great old days. She was an actress, she was a painter, she was a poet, she did many things, and she traveled the country with a stage play made in the Ozarks, and so I thought I'd put together some pictures from those scrapbooks. She was in the University Ladies Club for many years, and a past president, and she also did book reviews on Access TV. She had a very adventurous life, and we will miss her. So thanks a lot for watching the show, and I hope you enjoy it.
Is that thing on?
You're going to tell me the story.
What story of what?
I want to know the story. So we can get all the people in California straight on who is who. Aunt Maureen is second cousin to me.
Yes.
Okay. Okay.
Because she's my first cousin.
She
first cousins come after your...
How does she relate to...
They had the same...
Uncle Morris.
Uncle Morris is her father.
Uncle Morris is her father.
My mother was Uncle Morris's sister.
Your mother.
There were just two, Uncle Morris and Eileen, brother and sister.
Oh, I see. And Elise is your...
Friend.
Friend, no?
High school friend.
High school friend.
Not many people can say they have a high school friend that's lasted for a year.
Not very many people.
I'm not saying she was in the same grade. I think she was below me. I graduated before her. But we lived in the same neighborhood and took...
Not in Oregon.
No, in California, Hollywood. As I grew up in California, and I went to school, and I decided to take the train back from California to the East, New York. This is in 1940. I was 23 years old. New York was a destination at that time for young people who wanted to pursue the adventure of going into the theater. And that was one of the things that I wanted to do. Oh,
There were many inspirations to go to because just before the coming of the Great War, and the theater was alive and promising. However, as the months went by, we could see that war was imminent and taking our young men daily. I went to live in New York City in a girls' boarding house called the Rehearsal Club. There were about 60 young ladies that roomed there, and we got two meals a day, breakfast and dinner. The rest of the day was supposed to be set out by pursuing jobs.
The stage door cantina.
Well, first I went downtown LA from Maiden to Ozark. And when that closed, I went to New York.
Yeah.
And then I fluttered around in New York.
No, Dad.
After a rehearsal club.
You got the audition in L.A.
Sure did. Oh, what? What audition?
For Maiden in Ozark.
Right?
Oh, yeah. Right out of, I graduated from City College, and one of our graduates had gone down to try out for this play that two men were going to put on because they had not inherited, but it came upon them from some money collateral that they had, the Orange Grove Theater in downtown Los Angeles, the two brothers.
Ah.
And they said, well, we got this old theater.
Yeah.
Let's use it. They didn't know beans about putting on a theater. So they got a lady who wrote a play called Maiden in Ozark, and they got a man, Leon Lord. To direct it, and
then you took it on the road.
No, not from there. And then they had a troop of kids that came down there trying out for all the various parts, and I got one of them.
That's great.
And they said, well, since you live here, all you need is $10 a week bus fare. So I got $10 a week.
How many shows did you have to do a week?
7, 8,
In downtown L.A.?
Mm-hmm.
That's great. Can't do that now, then.
Whole deal.
So when did you take it? When did you follow it to New York?
No, wait a minute. So then, the Belasco Theater became vacant, and they said, well, we'll move it over to the Belasco and make it a little better show.
Bigger production value.
So we did 139 shows there.
Okay.
That's what it says in my record.
Oh, you were looking it up. 139?
Hmm?
Well, that's good stuff.
Then, some of the exes of Los Angeles City College, including a friend of mine, said she was going to New York. And
I see.
That if I wanted to join up with them in New York, all I had to do was get that train fare and you go to New York.
No.
So I said goodbye to Maiden Ozark.
In L.A. This is before the war.
Hmm?
This
mm-hmm.
is before the war. Now,
when 39-40. Aunt Jo and Grandma dressed me to the hilt. Hat, coat, outfit, shoes, sock, dress. I was going to New York in style.
You went to New York in style. And then you got...
And I was going to stay at the Barbican Plaza.
That's a Manhattan?
New York. Manhattan.
Oh, really? The Barbican? I've heard of that.
Yeah, that's right.
That's Manhattan.
Grandpa Casey. I'm going to pay my rent. And...
In downtown Manhattan? Soho?
A very popular place for young ladies. Well, let me tell you, it was like a prison. It was a sparse bedroom. A bed and a bureau.
You get what you get.
Big bucks. Big money.
$200 a week?
I don't know. And my friend Sarah, who I knew in Los Angeles, she said, for what the price that you're paying for the Barbizon Plaza, we could get an apartment, $85 a month.
Yeah.
I had the money. And...
She didn't.
Sarah didn't.
Well, hello there. I'm reading the morning paper, and I always look first for the weather report. Ah, here it is. Oh, good. It's been snowing for 3 days, but today it says the sky will be clear and there will be a melt off. That's always very good news. And then I turn the pages and I try to find a good murder story. Very often, that is how novelists and playwrights get their best stories, right here, out of the newspaper. Well, come on in, ladies and gentlemen. I had Frank come out early this morning to light up the fire in the stove so we wouldn't all catch pneumonia during this investigation. We have to find a motive and some cues. Do you think she did it? And Mrs. Hale says, well, I don't know. She just asked for her little apron and her shawl. No, I don't think she did it. Besides, Mr. Hale says there is a shotgun in the house if she really wanted to do him in.
And I had friends within this club people would call and say they would need somebody for certain jobs. So I went as a model, mm-hmm. and I did that with sketch artists. They would order the clothes from Bergdorf Goodman and B. Altman and some of the fashionable department stores of New York City. And then I would try on the clothes, and I happened to work for a lady who did the sketching. And they would appear sometimes in Vogue magazines. Well, anyway, then also I worked at the theater wing that was called the Stage Door Canteen, mm-hmm. where the soldiers of the armed forces and the Navy would come for refreshment and relaxation, and they would get to see some of the stars that were appearing on the stage, and they would come and serve the meals, like the lunch and Catherine Cornell and people of that time. It was a very stimulating experience. I did get into a show that was of some significance. And I went back to Chicago, and that show went and took a train. We're coming into the train episodes again, and the train was a sort of a troop train, and there were many soldiers on it, and this little theatrical company that I was with, and we were gone 13 weeks on the road from Detroit and Youngstown, Ohio, and many cities back in the Midwest. And then the show closed, and I'd been gone 2 years, and so I decided to go home to California. And I took my all my things that I had collected and took the train from New York Grand Central Station.
Mm-hmm. What was the name of the show?
Oh, well, that was Made in the Ozarks. It lasted for two years and 13 weeks. But I had had enough of that. That was in the past, but it was a good experience. Mm-hmm. And so, I went home, and I hadn't been home very long when the phone rang, and it was a young fellow that I used to know some time before. His name was Frederick Hunter, and he invited me out. And we went to Ciro's. Mm-hmm. At that time, that was quite an experience to go to a nightclub.
This is in Los Angeles.
In Hollywood. And Fred and I, we played badminton. We went to the beach. And we swam in the cold Pacific Ocean. And we had a jolly good time together. And we became engaged. And then he was sent back because he'd been overseas in Okinawa. And he said, well, he promised that when the war was over, we would get married. Well, he went on up to Seattle, where his troop ship was to take him back to Hawaii. And then the telephone rang, and he said, there are rumors that the war is going to be over, So why don't you come up to Seattle and we'll get married. So my father pulled some pretty heavy strings and we got Pullman berths to go from Los Angeles to Seattle, Washington.
How many days did it take?
It just took one night. And during the train trip in the middle of the night, the conductor came through the train. This was August 14th, 1945. The conductor came through the train and he said, "The war is over." Mm-hmm. Well, in those days, you had curtains that were pulled together to confine you in your little Pullman. Can you imagine all the curtains popping open and little faces peering out and in wonder and delight, and everybody in their pajamas and their bathrobes getting up and whoopee, 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 you know.
But you had to ship out. You didn't get married.
Well, no, wait a minute. Yeah.
Well.
So he comes and bends on his knee, and he brings this little bitty diamond, about the size of a peanut.
Boy, are we getting this one on there? This is a humdinger here. This is a story all unto itself, isn't it? I don't even have a wide enough shot for that. That's funny. Okay, go ahead.
So about 2 weeks. So anyway, he brings me home to the Granger's big estate, you know, beautiful. And so he comes in his uniform and everything. And he did bend on bended knee. And he said, you know, we become engaged.
Okay.
And I said, okay.
Okay.
And so then he takes off and goes to war.
No, I was called.
Yeah, and then
I was told that a ship will leave Seattle such and such a day.
August 15th.
And I will have to be there, and I would have to fly from my little place there in California up to Seattle.
He was staying with his parents.
And you were in L.A. This is L.A.
Yeah.
At the time. And you had to go from L.A. to Seattle.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, he was staying with his mom and dad.
Uh-huh.
And one night we had a dinner with mom and dad and me, so he could meet.
I never met your parents.
No, you were a little bitty baby.
Thank you.
And so we arrived in Seattle, and Lieutenant Fred Hunter met us, my father and I, at the station, and we went to the Olympic Hotel, mm-hmm. where my father and I had a reservation. But Fred had to go back to his quarters for the night. But we would be married the next day, so that I could stay on while we made other arrangements, because Fred thought he would not be going back overseas, and his little troop ship was going to leave without him. I don't know how he pulled this off, but he did. Mm-hmm. And we got a minister, and we got a church, but there was nobody there but just the minister and his wife and my father and Hiram Casey. And Fred went out looking for some flowers, and all the florists were closed, but he found the remnants of some flowers left over from a funeral or something. Oh. And I had some woe-begone gladiolas. But I did have a trousseau, because I had gone in Los Angeles to the big Wilshire Bullocks clothing store and had bought a watermelon pink overcoat. It was absolutely beautiful. And I had a gray suit and a little gray hat and several white blouses that I bought with bows and whatnot on. So I felt that I did have a wedding outfit of a sort. Mm-hmm. But anyway, Grandpa Casey went back to Hollywood and Los Angeles by himself on the train. And then Dad and our adventure as a married couple began. That was in Walla Walla.
That was in Walla Walla.
Well, they had, for entertainment, mm-hmm. Yes, a group of the faculty people. Mm-hmm. A new daddy was putting on plays at the little college. Mm-hmm. And so, just for fun, we got some of the townspeople mm-hmm. and the well, they had a little theater study group,
yeah.
and had Drama. Started it, and so they latched on to Dad and I mm-hmm. to help them with that, and we put on some kind of a one play one time.
The drama group,
and we called it. It's, I can't remember what it was called, but they thought it was a lot of fun, mm-hmm. and it was amateurish. Mm-hmm. But one lady had a beautiful home, And come to find out that they were in the bird's eye frozen pea and frozen vegetables, string beans. That's what they grow up there in Washington State. Mm-hmm. And certainly in a town like Walla Walla, there was just absolutely nothing to do. There was one movie theater and big hardware stores, because
buildings,
and but a very provincial town, mm-hmm. and had one hotel, and but most of the people there were farmers. That maybe they lived in the town, but their farms and acreage was outside of the town, and you could get out of Walla Walla, that we still had our Packard car, and we would just take drives in the country, mm-hmm. and see the sheep and the goats and the turkeys, and I thought it was a great deal of fun. To being a city girl, I thought that was a great deal of fun. And we'd put the baby in the car and go down to the big rivers, mm-hmm. and take picnics, yeah. and bundle up. It was always cold, always cold.
So then you went to California.
And then, yes, well, we did want to get out of this situation if we could, and further Dad's career.
Now, that was before, you went down to California, then back up to Eugene? Or?
Yeah, then after we got, Daddy got his, we went to Palo Alto and Menlo Park. We had phoned from Walla Walla. Places to live were still very scarce. And this was a brand new complex of little apartments that one man was building. And we phoned. And we said that we wanted to come, that Fred was going to be enrolled in Stanford, and he was going to teach a class on his GI Bill. And that would help financially. And so the man said that we sounded like, you know, dependable people. Uh-huh. And it was $90 a month rent. I remember that because we thought that was exorbitant, mm-hmm. but it was high for starting out. But anyway, we had some other money that came in too. So we packed up the little old Packard and scooty-dooed down to San Francisco. The apartment was not furnished. So between some of our friends and my grandmother, we got a cot and some beds and a dresser. Mm-hmm. And we bought a picnic table for the dining, well, just a little dining space. Instead of getting a dining room table, we bought a picnic table, which we thought we could use when we left there. And it was unpainted, and I remember Daddy varnished it and sanded it and all that sort of thing. That was our table. Oh, yeah. Aunt Jo lived in, well, she was around, you know. She was up at the ranch, mm-hmm. and all that, but I don't remember what. Yes, we stopped. We stopped at the ranch, the big peach orchard, mm-hmm. on our way to San Francisco.
Let's go, guys.
Okay.
That's the last coffee.
So far, there are no horrendous wrecks on 17.
You have a paper cup?
Yeah, you want to take a look at it?
Sure, I do. I didn't strip the bed either.
No, no, that's all right. I'll do it.
Stairs to the end. This time, when you take my picture, I will stand up straight.
And then you'll fall over backwards.
Then I'll fall over backwards.
Casey will take it. Here, I'll take it. Wait for Daddy. He's gonna get a picture.
So this time we didn't take the train, we went by automobile from Ames, Iowa, to Walla Walla, Washington. And on the way there, we stopped in Yellowstone National Park. And we had in the back seat of our Packard car, a food with a cooler with some ice in it, and some cheeses and some food. And we thought we were pretty smart doing things like that because we didn't have to stop there weren't as many, you see, motels and hotels, and there were no Denny's, and there were no little places you could just run off the road like today when every gas station has a pickup place to get food. So we carried most of our little provisions with us.
Did that have grocery stores?
They had grocery stores. So we had picked up this little ice chest, and it had a little sliding cover on the top. It was very neat. I don't know where the water went, but there was some in the bottom of it, I guess. But it was made for travel. And we had that in the back seat of our car. And when we stayed all night in Yellowstone, we had left the back window open about, oh, so small a space, about 2 inches. And the next morning when we got up, the upholstery in the back seat of our car had been torn by a bear. The bear had gotten its claws in just enough to rip out for that, because we were very naive and didn't know that we should have taken the ice chest out and hung it up on a tree or something. But anyway, that was part of our adventure.
Here it comes. I knew it.
You, get
you can't win.
I knew it. 45 BJ Day. Huh? One, two, three.
Oh, give me a home where the buffalo roam and the deer and the antelope play. Happy anniversary to you from the Old Faithful crew. Have fun and enjoy your big day.
Happy anniversary to you.
That's so great.
The tradition is you have to blow them out simultaneously. That's your tradition.
Okay.
That's very nice.
Blow them out simultaneously. Okay. One, two.
Shall I do it or you do it?
Both. Simultaneously. One, two, three. Three. Blow.
We did. All right. Happy anniversary.
I'm putting my feelers out. And that's when Gaddy and I went to meet Dorothy L'Amour and all those people.
Oh, I see.
Trying to get
some jobs
in the movie.
Ah, that's great.
And then?
Wait a minute, how did you get gypped in the jury? That's what I want to know.
What?
How did you get in the short movie, the Columbia Picture short movie? Gypped
well,
in the jury.
That's what I'm trying to remember.
Because is that after Chicago or before, or is that when you came back to L.A.?
Gosh, I can't remember.
You must have hooked up with some people at the L.A. City College again or something.
It was during the run in the Ozarks.
Not in
LA. That they called backstage and they said, Columbia Pictures man said that to come down and try out for a Vera Vague comedy. And when was that?
That must have been in the 30s.
This entire jury insist on voting not guilty. It isn't fair to the state. It isn't fair to us. It isn't fair to the accused.
There was no evidence to substantiate a guilty verdict, and I feel he's innocent. Besides, how could a man be guilty with such soulful eyes?
Soulful eyes, nothing. You're just a stubborn mule.
What's the matter? Did he buy your wool?
Mom and Dad and Fred went to dinner someplace in Los Angeles.
Yeah.
So they could meet, Mom and Dad could meet me.
Yeah, that's right.
And I had met your mother previously in San Jose someplace. I don't know when that was.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, then he gets his call to go back to wherever.
South Pacific.
And then there were rumors that the war was going to be over.
I see.
So he called me on the phone and he said, tell your dad, Grandpa Casey, to get ready to bring you, me, up to Seattle to get married, because they're going to ship me out.
That's right.
So you get on the night train.
So Daddy Casey pulled some strings, and he got us two berths on the night train to Seattle.
Right.
And when we were going through various
stops from L.A. to San Francisco, San Francisco?
We took it at L.A.
Portland.
And we took the train in L.A.
Yeah.
My daddy and then, Fred's mother and father were down there.
And it stops
at the train station.
In L.A.
In L.A. No, 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 no. Daddy was gone.
Yeah.
Daddy was up there.
Yeah.
Grandpa Casey had to get the ticket out to get the Pullman car to go to Seattle. And in the middle of the night, the train conductor came
through. I was making a military reservation with my officers in the air base near, not far from Sacramento, near Yuba City.
Yeah.
And that air base was going to ship me to Seattle.
I see.
So I had to make the arrangements to get to Seattle.
Yeah, because you got to get on a slow boat to China.
So while he was stuck there, Aunt Jo and Aunt Elaine wanted to meet Fred.
Oh, now wait a minute.
Right.
Now we're getting the timeline.
Before we were married.
See, I didn't know where that came in. I thought that came in months before.
No,
very quick, just like this.
So you were in Yuba City, and then you had to go out there.
you were making arrangements. That's when you went and met Aunt Jo.
And the old-fashioned. The old-fashioned drink.
Came and got me in.
You had old-fashions?
I wasn't there. He was there.
What about you? Did you ever have
I was in... Well, anyway, he was met at the airport with Mr. Weinberger, the chauffeur of her limousine, went out to pick up Fred in uniform, second lieutenant.
At the air base.
At the air base. And they brought him back to the ranch.
Right. Put me up on the porch. And we had Southern Comfort.
You had drinks.
That's great.
Okay.
They had drinks.
And then they had to take him back to the porch.
They grilled him for an hour.
Oh, yeah.
Well, I don't know if he grilled them or they grilled him.
At least an hour.
But anyway,
now, Aunt Jo's farm is the one that Dorothy Wilbur.
Ranch,
the Dorothy Wilbur. The ranch.
Aunt Elaine's ranch.
Right.
She owned it.
Aunt Elaine.
Aunt Jo was her dearest friend and lived with her. Like if I had Emma living with me.
Oh, yeah, that's a good idea.
Well, that's the idea of it.
But we would never do that.
They were school days.
School days.
From Santa Cruz. Lived in Santa Cruz.
That's great.
See? Aunt Elaine, Aunt Jo, Grandma all lived in Santa Cruz.
Santa Cruz is the center of the earth.
Particular time.
No, when they were children.
Over the time.
Young people. They stuck together.
You got married and then you were shipped out. That was it.
No
honeymoon.
No way.
No. Grandpa Casey comes train. Fred meets us. We had Daddy and I, Casey and I, had reservations at the Olympia
Hotel.
Daddy was out at the base.
Ah, okay.
Right.
So, Daddy said, we could get... We could get married. This war's over. And
so you didn't have to go back.
So then they said all those recruits weren't going anyplace. So Daddy, Grandpa Fred went around and got a judge.
That's right.
We got a judge. We didn't really get a minister, but we did go to a church.
Yes.
And we got him. He got a marriage license. He got the flowers and everything, and we got married.
Marriage in Seattle.
In Seattle, and Grandpa Casey was at our wedding dinner, and that's when Grandpa Casey brought out all these goodies, like the gold chain and a cross and all this stuff that he'd been harboring for years to give to his daughter on her wedding day.
You know? Oh, that's great. That's great.
So then we were supposed to see Grandpa Casey off on the train, but we never got there.
He went down to L.A.
He went back home. I stayed with Daddy. And then when he was matriculated to leave, we took a train to Santa Ana, California.
Well, the boat never left.
Yeah, so we took a train and then Daddy says,
she and I were all prepared for me
to leave.
Get on a boat and go to the South Pacific, but they decided that the boat need not go. So
it was fate.
I love it. See? Now, the question is, you went back to L.A.
So she and I went back to L.A.
We went to Santa Ana to get matriculated.
That's great.
That's getting out of the Army.
I know that. I did that. You remember? I got out of the Navy.
Okay.
I'm a roving cowboy, riding all day long. sunny song. Nights underneath a prairie moon, I ride along and sing a tune.
See them tumble and down, pledging their love to the ground.
This is not any ordinary train, because this goes way back to the 1860s when the immigrants were coming to California. They came by a wagon train. Oh, some of the parties included 100 wagons. But this particular train was a very large group of people, and among them was a 16-year-old girl, and she was traveling with her parents, who were going to be called gold seekers. A wagon train goes about 25 miles a day, if they're lucky. And it's pulled by horses and oxen.
How you do, ma'am? We're looking for Reverend Longley.
The Reverend's at his meditation.
Well, I'm Julian Shea. I've been commissioned by the Assembly.
The Assembly?
Yes, ma'am.
Praise God, deliverance. Reverend? Reverend? Reverend?
How do you do? I'm Julian Shea.
Howdy.
This is my wife, Rachel.
How do you do?
The Assembly sent them.
Sent you to replace me?
Well, yes, sir, but there's no urgency.
What do you take for that wagon?
You want to buy my wagon?
Well, I don't necessarily like the looks of that hind wheel, but I'll tell you what. You keep our furniture, we'll take the wagon, and that's fair.
Now, don't go trading the furniture, Reverend.
Let's just go, Mama.
Yes, Reverend.
Do we have a trade?
Certainly.
Well, let's get her unloaded then.
I came with pretties like that.
Oh, really?
Yes, really.
This young girl grew to be my grandmother. And she said that it wasn't always just the oxen and the mules and the horses that brought them across the plains, as they were called, but it was the grasslands. If they hadn't been fed by grass, they never would have made it.
Oh, it was so funny. So I went and bought a dress, had my hair done, and all that, just to be him.
Crisscross across the Atlantic, and of course it took a longer time. Sometimes they took as much as a month to come
from France to America. And that's why I'm emphasizing to you in the audience about Sarah's delight and enjoyment of America. However, she went back to France, and whom does she meet but the famous, famous playwright Oscar Wilde. And he is a very strange person too, and oddly enough, he's British. His French was not very adequate either, but they became good friends, and he wrote the play Salome for Sarah Bernhardt, in which she played many an outstanding performance. Sarah Bernhardt, the book is written by Cornelia Otis Skinner, whose father was a very famous actor of Shakespeare. And Cornelia Otis Skinner, who is still alive and lives in New York City, had written this fabulous book about Madame Sarah. Sarah Bernhardt lived to be 79 years old, and she performed right up to, she was going to go on the stage one night when her manager said, "No, Sarah, we don't think you can perform tonight." And she slowly went back to her dressing room and never performed again. But she is looked upon with reverence and great applause. Thank you very much for listening.